Hey, there you are. Welcome. I'll wait just a few moments until everyone has been admitted in the session. Good. Well, good evening, everyone. I appreciate that you have decided to spend one of your lockdown nights with me and Chantal. I also think that it's smart that you're here, as it may happen that I'm going to show you a thing or two about all these new technologies that are transforming the world and what you can do to stay relevant. Well, this webinar is organized and hosted by JOTS, the Jeronimus Academy of Data Science. We are a school in Den Bosch, and as you see on the pictures, we have a very nice campus. Actually, our campus in Den Bosch used to be a convent until 7 years ago. And as you see here, the former chapel is now our main auditorium. Of course, it's lockdown now, but we are still hoping that in the near future we can teach in the campus again. JOTS is actually a school, a graduate school, that was founded by two universities. One of them is the University of Eindhoven, which is a university of technology, and the other one is the Tilburg University. And those two universities decided to jointly establish a school on data science and AI. And that was motivated by the vision that data science is essentially a multidisciplinary field. It has a technical side to it, and it has a business side to it. You also see our motto here: we do cool stuff that matters with data. JOTS is not a purely academic institution. Sure, we do research, we offer a master program, PhD program, but in addition, it's also an important part of our mission to have impact on business and industry and society. And that is the reason why we organize webinars like this one. So who is the talking head? Well, that's me. My name is Jeroen. And within JOTS, I'm the Academic Director of Professional Education. That means that I'm responsible for the programs that we offer for professionals, for managers, for executives. I'm also active in the field of data science. I'm actually a professor of statistics and data science for the University of Waterloo. I'll give you a few seconds to think about in which country is Waterloo. And the correct answer that it's in Canada. Well, why are we here? That's because I want to talk with you about the question that you see here: how to stay relevant in times of big data, machine learning, and AI. And that key question has a number of dimensions. First of all, I want to explain a little bit about what is data science and big data and machine learning, AI? What are we talking about? And also, I want to talk about why do these new technologies have so much impact? I also want to demystify it a bit. Words like artificial intelligence, deep learning, machine learning, wow, that sounds impressive. As you will see, it's just a mathematical equation. But then in the second half of the webinar, I want to talk about what do all these new technologies and the impact that they have, what does that mean for me, meaning you in particular, and for your careers, for your profession, and what new roles and career profiles can you find in the world of data and AI? The good news is that I see some of you nodding. That means that these questions are of interest to you. It could happen that you have even more questions. No worries. I'll try to make sure that at the end of the webinar, we have ample time for your questions that you want to address. We are a relatively large group, so the webinar itself is not going to be very interactive, but I'll reserve some time at the end for questions that you want to address. Well, having said that, I really miss teaching in a classroom where I can see you and hear you. In an online environment, it's always a bit difficult to organize that, but you really do me a big favor if you could make me aware a little bit of your presence and make me aware that I'm talking to a bunch of nice living folks. What I'm going to do, please unmute your Zoom for a second. And once you have unmuted your Zoom, then I'm going to count down to zero. And at zero, please say good evening in your native language. There we go. That's 3, 2, 1, 0.
Good evening. Good evening. Good
evening. Yeah.
Okay. That really does me a pleasure. You cannot imagine how alienating it is to talk to us to a display and not having any idea of that there's actually human beings at the other side. That said, this is a good moment to mute your microphone again. Now, let's go into the topic that I want to discuss. First half of the webinar, I want to talk a bit about data science, AI, big data. What are we talking about? And why do they have so much impact in the world? So first of all, what is data science? And if you look it up at the internet, you'll find a lot of different definitions. What most of them have in common is that data science is a multidisciplinary field. And at YOTS, we define it to be a combination of data engineering, data analytics, and data entrepreneurship. Where data engineering is about IT, it's about data infrastructures, about data warehousing, the cloud, Internet of Things, that sort of infrastructures. Data analytics is about analyzing data in order to get information out of it, and maybe in order to drive decisions and conclusions. So that involves machine learning, but also BI, business intelligence, business information, and even artificial intelligence. Finally, data engineering and data analytics are profoundly reshaping what businesses do and how they do it. And if I say businesses, I also mean public sector, I mean hospitals, pretty much every organization. And this impact of what of analytics and data engineering on what organizations do and how they do it, that is called data entrepreneurship. Now, data scientists work in a world that is changing rapidly. There's a lot of new technologies. And many fields are going through profound structural changes. My own field is industry. And in industry, we talk about industry 4.0, had a fourth industrial revolution or smart industry. But also think about accounting, for example. I think that in a few years' time, algorithms will take over a lot of the work that is now done by humans. And that will, of course, drastically alter the work and the role of accountants. Or think about doctors. It'll be just a few years until algorithms are better at interpreting X-rays and MRI scans than radiologists. And that will fundamentally change the field of radiology. Also, our society is going through some transitions, for example, the transition towards a circular economy. And in many fields, you will see the burgeoning of new concepts and business models, new ways in which we provide value as an organization. Now, many of these changes are driven by data science technology. And I always like to summarize that in the motto that you see here. Data science, new forms of data, new analytics, creating new business opportunities. that is vague and high level. Therefore, I want to make it a bit more tangible. I'm going to show you four examples of how data science is applied. And based on them, I want to explain a bit what I mean by new forms of data, new analytics, and new business opportunities. So here's my first example. It's an example in the fashion industry, but I think that the same application is applied in a lot of different fields. What they do in the fashion industry is that they collect data about sales statistics, but they also analyze blog posts and other social media postings posted on the internet. And based on that sort of data sources, they analyze and they try to predict trends in demand. And what's the value of that? Well, if you can predict what demand for certain product lines will be, you can make sure that you have the right number of products at the right time, in the right volume, at the right place. Now, that's a typical application of data science, and predicting customer demand is applied in almost every industry now, including services and healthcare, simply because it's so terribly important for the efficient planning of capacity. What's noteworthy of this example, I'm going to expand on that in a second, is that data is not only numbers like in sales statistics, it's also social media postings like tweets and posts posted on Facebook, for example. This is my second example, and this example is from a retail bank, a credit provider. Essentially, what they want to do is if a prospect customer applies for a loan, then it's important for the credit provider to assess the risk that the customer will default on the loan, that they will not pay back the loan. And in the old days, that was an assessment based on a lot of gut feeling. Nowadays, they have a lot of information about you. I will show you the data set in a second. They know a lot about you, about your background, about your income, about your credit score. Also, applicants fill out a description of the purpose for which they want to spend the loan. Again, that's in natural language. What's the business value of that? Well, if you can assess the risk that a customer will not pay back their loan, of course, that's very valuable information in deciding whether you should accept the loan application. Let's discuss these first two examples a bit more in depth. First of all, let's talk about new forms of data, big data. What you see here on the left-hand side, that's what a data set used to look like. It could be an Excel table with lots of numbers. Nowadays, this is also what data looks like. It could be pieces of text in natural language. It could be chat messages that can also be analyzed. As a matter of fact, the word big data refers to what they call the three V's. Data volume, we have much bigger data sets nowadays. How did that happen? Well, that is because of this whole new cluster of technologies like the Internet of Things. All of our devices are being connected to the internet, so we can collect large volumes of data. Data storage has become very cheap, for example, in the cloud. Sensors have become cheap, so it's cheap to and easy to collect data. They also talk about data velocity. In the old days, a data set was a table of data that you analyze, and then you draw your conclusions and you get on with it. Nowadays, data is collected real time. We no longer talk about data sets, we talk about data streams. In the former days, the Dutch Air Force owned a jet fighter called the F-16. Now we have the F-35, the Joint Strike Fighter, The Joint Strike Fighter produces the same amount of data in 30 seconds as the F-16 generated in 30 years. So that's what we mean by data volume and data velocity. Perhaps the biggest change is data variety. Data are no longer numbers and tables. Nowadays, we can also use images and photos as data and pieces of text in natural language, such as reviews posted on internet retailers or social media posts. Audio, video can all be analyzed as data. And that is what we mean by big data. Now, here's the actual data set that this credit provider uses. I'm sure it's difficult to read. The important part is that every row is a former loan applicant. And in the column that's labeled Y here, you see zeros and ones, and that means whether or not this particular applicant in the end has defaulted on their loan or not. And that's what we want to predict. All the other columns labeled X's, and they're called features, and there's a lot more of them. There's a total of 110 more columns. That's all the information that they have about you. So that is whether or not you own a car, whether or not you own a house, what your income is, whether you have kids, the total net value of your goods, your education, etc., etc., etc. Now, what is it that all this new analytics, machine learning, AI, deep learning, supervised learning, all these fancy words, what is it that all these techniques do? It's actually pretty simple. They try to predict a Y variable, in this case, whether or not an applicant will default on their loan. They try to predict that on the basis of all the X values, the features. And that is essentially what all these techniques do. They are prediction machines. They can predict stuff. And so if you follow up a bit on all these new techniques in machine learning, what you're looking at here is part of a programming language that's used a lot for machine learning that's called Python. These are some of the techniques, some of the sorts of algorithms that you can develop in Python, but there are a lot more. And they have fancy names like deep learning, supervised learning, machine learning, random forests, neural networks. The good news is all these techniques do the same thing. And that is that they want to predict a Y value, some response value, such as whether or not a customer will pay back their loan, based on a lot of features, a lot of X values. And so this is pretty much how machine learning works. You need a historical data set. So you need to have data about loan applicants in the past. And then based on this data set, you do something that in machine learning, they call it training, model fitting. But that is not something very special. What you are doing essentially is you're fitting a mathematical equation. A mathematical equation that takes as its input all these X's, the features, all this information that this bank knows about you, and the output is the probability that you will pay back the loan. It's a mathematical equation. And you can call it the neural network, you can call it deep learning, you can call it the random forest. In the end, it's a mathematical equation. What's the use of this mathematical equation? And you can use it, and you can call it an algorithm or a model or a classifier that mean the same thing. The idea is that once that you have fitted the model, once you have trained the algorithm, you can use it for new applicants. So if a new loan application approaches you, then you fill in all the information that you have about them. And the algorithm will tell you what's the probability that the customer will pay back their loan. That's it. That's what machine learning is all about. Oh, sorry, I pressed the wrong button here. That's where I was. Hesso predicting based on X variables features, we predict a Y variable. The same for the other example, there we collected data sources like sales statistics and social media posts, and we use them to predict demand. Now, what you see here is the range of application of data and analytics in organizations. And it ranges from data and analytics in order to control existing processes and services more efficiently to improving product designs. And that's actually the first two examples that you saw. Loan applications and supply chain management in the fashion industry, that's an existing process. And we use data and analytics simply to improve it, to make it faster and more efficient. The last two examples that I'm going to show you, they go further. They are more innovative. They use data and analytics to make products better, to enrich product designs. And the last example goes even further than that. The last example shows you data and analytics as a new business model. Let's see what that looks like. Well, the example, the product in question is rather low tech. It's tires for cars, but even car tires are made smart now. What does that mean? Well, sensors are very cheap nowadays. So car tires nowadays have sensors built into them. And based on what they measure, we can predict the optimal time to replace a tire. What's the value of that? Well, it will prevent that you get a flat tire it simply will prevent that you get a flat tire. That's it. While at the same time, you minimize the premature replacement. That's an example of data and analytics to make products smarter. And a lot of products are made smarter. My phone is smart. My TV is smart. My bank account is smart. My electricity consumption meter is smart. And smart refers to exactly this, that you enrich products by using data and analytics. Note, by the way, that also this example is an example of prediction where we use the sensor readings in order to predict whether the tire will blow out. The last example is the most important one. You see it here. A car manufacturer sells insurances. Let's first look at what they do. All car manufacturers do this by now, by the way. A traditional insurance company has this sort of data. They know how old you are. They know how old your car is. But if you build the cars, then you can equip the car with lots of sensors. And that means that you can collect data about where the car is driven and about the driving style and about when a car is driven. And if you think about it, that is a good basis to offer a more attractive insurance product than a traditional insurance company can offer. So that is sort of the thinking, but the ramifications are huge because what we are talking about here is a car manufacturer that goes into financial services. All car manufacturers are doing this and they expect that by 2030, so that's 8 years from now, about half of their total revenue will come from financial services like this one's. Wow, think about it. That totally changes what car manufacturers do. And the old business model is a car manufacturer like BMW or Volkswagen or Peugeot. And what they do is they design cars and then they manufacture them. And then they sell them to you. The new business model is that they will still manufacture cars, but they use these hardware products in order to, as a sort of a platform, to make revenue on financial services. This is, by the way, the reason why car manufacturers no longer are trying to sell you a car. They're trying to sell you a lease contract, because this lease contract, that contains a lot of these financial services, like insurances, maintenance service, financing services. This is happening in a lot of fields. A lot of fields, a lot of organizations will need to reconsider what they do. For example, at Yacht, we work for the waterschappen in the Netherlands, the water boards, the government organizations that manage the water and the dikes, etc. They estimate that 5 years from now, about 50% of the work that's now being done by employees, 5 years from now, 50% of that work will be done by algorithms, by machines. If you get stuck in that mindset, that means that you will get half the size that you are now. We try to stimulate them to think more innovatively, because data and analytics will also bring new opportunities for the Dutch waterschappen to be of value. Maybe the data that they collect about the waterways, they are, well, I'm pretty sure they have a lot of value for farmers, for example. So maybe you can also invent new business models. Now, that is pretty much what is going on in the world. Data and analytics are changing what we already do. They make current processes better, more dependable, faster, more flexible, more efficient. But they also create new opportunities to be of value. And that means that many organizations need to reconsider what they are doing. What is our mission? What is our business? And in the theory of business innovation, that's called Horizon 1 versus Horizon 3. And the picture that goes with it is this one. And that is what we ask organizations to do, to make a roadmap for how they see themselves develop, including data and analytics application in their current products and markets, but also the future markets, and even including new potential business models. Well, that is painting a picture of what is going on in the world, how the world is changing, and how much impact data and analytics are generating. Let's now turn to the key question for tonight. What does that mean for us, for our careers, for what do we need to do in order to stay relevant? As a matter of fact, there are a lot of new job titles emerging. And many of these new job titles, they have to do with data, analytics, information technology, robotics, etc., etc. And I'm not going to discuss them. For one, I see these job titles come and go. Secondly, I can imagine that that is terribly boring. If you are interested, however, then a very useful document is this one, and you can download it free from the internet. It's the Future of Jobs report. It's written by the World Economic Forum, and they publish it every 5 years. And in this, the Future of Jobs report, they explain a bit how they see the job market change. A few of the things that you can find there is, for example, which jobs are increasing in demand and what sort of jobs are decreasing in demand. And the list is a lot longer. Note, by the way, that in the jobs that are increasing in demand, that a lot of them directly have to do with data and analytics. Data analysts and scientists is on number one. Number two is AI and machine learning specialists. The only exceptions I found is here there's project managers that does not directly involve data and analytics, and somewhere here, business development professionals. If you're interested to see what jobs are on the uptide and what jobs are on the downtide, or if you're interested what do these jobs involve, by all means, consult this document. Another interesting section in this document is what sort of skills do future generations need? Us working in higher education, for us, this is an important document. We need to know what sort of skills do we need to teach our students. The number one is analytical thinking and innovation, active learning and learning strategies, complex problem solving. That's the top three. Now, instead of discussing in detail what all these new job titles mean, what I want to do here is sketch the landscape a bit and propose a few general directions in which the job market is developing and what sort of opportunities you can find. Now, first of all, I believe that everyone needs to know a thing or two about data and analytics and AI. What are they? What can you do with them? What are the risks? And that's not only my opinion. A couple of months ago, I believe in November, in the Netherlands, the WRF, that is the Wetenschappelijke Raad voor Regeringsbeleid, the scientific council that advises the Dutch government, they produced this report here. And in this report, they identify AI and data as what they call a system technology, on par with, for example, steam engines and the invention of electricity. And by that, they mean that this new cluster of technologies is going to have so much impact on the world that nobody can ignore it. That's what I mean by system technology. And as a consequence, everyone should have a basic level of what they call data and AI literacy. On top of that, I believe that executives, directors, they need to learn how to manage a data-driven business, a data-driven organization. Also, they need to know a thing or two about data and how that transforms how organizations work. How can you become data and AI literate? Well, the good news is that the government is preparing a very extensive program called the Nationale AI Coalition. And they're going to offer this program to very widely, to a lot of professionals. So chances are that you will come across it at some stage in the next few years. If you can't wait, I can recommend books like this one. This book is called Hello World, Hello Computer, written by Maurits Kaptein. That book is a very nice introduction into the digital world. It tells you how your email works. It will tell you how autonomous cars work. It tells you how the internet works. It tells you how machine learning works. And it's very easy to understand. So how to remain relevant? Well, I believe that all professionals need to have a certain literacy in data and AI, simply because it's going to be a system technology. It will pervade everything that we do. Now let's turn to career developments more directly related to data science. And I believe that in data science, there's roughly two sorts of directions. On the left-hand side, it's more the technology-oriented jobs. On the right-hand side, you'll find the more business-oriented jobs. And by business, as I said before, I also mean organizations in the public sector, in healthcare. But these, to put it very easily. These are people who generally like to learn programming in Python or something like that. These people don't, but they will need to work with data and analytics anyway. Let's talk about them in a little bit more detail. First, the technology-oriented jobs. There's a lot of them. Again, roughly sketching the landscape a bit, I believe that a lot of jobs could be classified as being about data engineering, and they are jobs about data infrastructures, like databases, data warehousing, data pipelines, the cloud, the Internet of Things. That's what data engineering jobs involve. Roughly, the other half of technology-oriented jobs in data science, they are about analytics, starting with very basic descriptive analytics, which is all about reporting and BI, to a bit more mathematical predictive analytics, that's machine learning and AI, and building algorithms, to relatively mathematical jobs that are called prescriptive analytics, which is business analytics, econometrics, OR, where they deal with complex optimization issues. Now, the key question was how to stay relevant. And if your current job is in technology, then I believe that the key answer in that case is that you have to make sure that your skill set is T-shaped. What does that mean, a T-shaped skill set? That's another concept of the World Economic Forum, by the way. It means that your skills have a vertical bar and a horizontal bar. And the vertical bar is metaphorical for the fact that you need to be an expert in something. That could be machine learning, could be data engineering. You need to be an expert in something. And that expertise is a very good starting point for your career. However, once you get in your early 30s, if you want to grow further in your career, then only having this vertical bar is no longer good enough. In your 30s, you will need the horizontal bar, which in part is about that you need to become more broad. You need to understand the context of what you're doing. And depending on the field where you work, that could mean that you need to understand how businesses work, or how a hospital works, how the healthcare system works. You need to understand more and more of the context in which you are working. The horizontal bar also refers to what the World Economic Forum refers to as boundary crossing competencies. And this is part of their list. If you want to develop yourself further in your 30s, you will need to learn to become more entrepreneurial, meaning that you develop the skill to recognize opportunities and that you develop the skill to develop opportunities. You need to know a bit about leadership, how to get things done in complex organizations, problem solving, project management, critical thinking. Then let's turn to the more business-oriented careers in data science. And again, I believe that you can roughly identify two flavors of jobs there that I named analytics translators here and jobs in data or AI governance. First, the analytics translators. That's a word that was popularized by McKinsey, and it's being adopted more and more now in business and industry. The job of an analytics translator is that they think from their domain knowledge, and that could be in business, it could be in healthcare, medicine, it could be in engineering, and their job is to recognize opportunities where data and analytics could be of value. And the other part of their job is that they know enough about AI and machine learning and data to be able to translate a business opportunity into an analytics project. And then the analytics teams will develop it. And that is what they mean by an analytics translator. And so analytics translators are the ones who create this roadmap, identifying potential applications for data and analytics and translating them to projects for the analytics teams. The analytics teams can be in India, they can be in China. In the future, that may even be robots, machines. But it's the analytics translators who identify the opportunities. Then there will emerge more and more jobs that I would classify as being about data and AI governance. And that is all about the quality of data, the quality of the data that's stored in all these databases, including, for example, defining an appropriate data model. A data model is essentially the classifications, the fields that you use in your databases. If you have a bad data model, then all your databases are very difficult to connect and to merge. Because the name and address field in one database is inconsistent with the name and address field in the next database. And so that's what they mean by data modeling. Data and AI governance is becoming more and more important. And that is because the European Union is preparing a legal framework that they call Trustworthy AI. And that's an extension of the GDPR framework that they have now. The GDPR is about privacy. Trustworthy AI goes a lot further and also addresses the reliability of algorithms, how to prevent that algorithms are biased. You see here, diversity, non-discrimination and fairness. A lot of the algorithms that companies use nowadays, they have a bias. And that is going to be outlawed by this legal framework. Transparency. A lot of these predictive algorithms are black boxes. So if you apply for a loan and the algorithm estimates the probability that you will default to be very high, then maybe the algorithm will reject your application. However, that is no longer, well, it's not yet accepted, but if this legal framework is going to be implemented, that is no longer allowed. And you cannot simply tell a customer, sorry, computer says no. Algorithms for applications like that will need to be explainable. The customer has a right to get an explanation of the decision. Now, that sort of legal issues and quality issues and governance issues, that will become very important. And that is what I mean here by this second flavor of more business-oriented jobs in data science. Now, slowly moving towards the end, maybe an insight how to remain relevant, especially in these more business-oriented jobs in data science. Maybe one way to understand what is going on is that machines, robots, algorithms, they will be used more and more to do the primary routine work that is nowadays done by humans. But if that is the case, then the work for us, for humans, will shift more and more to the governance of the data and the analytics. That on the one hand. And so we will need to make sure that these algorithms are reliable, that they are explainable, that they are fair, that they are safe. And on the other hand, more and more human jobs will shift in the direction of translating data and analytics to business value. For example, if you work in a hospital, what can we do with data and analytics in medicine? or in care delivery, not the job of the analytics translator. I talked about accountants before. If the primary routine work of accountants is going to be digitized more and more, what accountants will do, they will become the auditors who audit the algorithms. That's what the accountancy profession is moving towards. And I think that will become a general trend. These are the words of McKinsey. McKinsey talks about these more business-oriented jobs in data science as being a bridge between a business function on the one hand, and that could be marketing, could be HR, could be engineering, could be medicine, being the bridge between such a domain function on the one hand and the data and analytics engineers and teams on the other hand. What we see happening at Yachts, let me see if I have a nice picture here somewhere. This is the one I'm looking for. In the previous decade, data science was largely driven by more technology-oriented jobs. The trend that we see now is that these more business-oriented jobs are becoming more and more important. And that is where we see a lot of growth. So we see a lot more analytics translators emerge, data and AI governance. Well, a few takeaways. First of all, the world is changing really rapidly. I'm 47 years old now. I find it scary. have we talked about new forms of data, new analytics, and they change what businesses do and how they do it. How to stay relevant? Well, part of it is everyone should make sure that they become data and AI literate, to have at least a basic understanding of what these new technologies do. If you favor a more technology-oriented career, then roughly the two flavors are data engineering versus analytics. However, we see a lot of growth in the more business-oriented jobs, which come in the flavors of translators and more into governance. Now, finally, especially for these latter two, how to get there? That's, of course, where we come in, because that is our job. I'm not going to tell you a lot about the programs that we offer at Yachts. I don't need to, because the vision that underlies the programs that we offer is exactly the vision that I have explained. So roughly, we offer two types of programs. One is for the more technically oriented professionals, where we teach them to develop machine learning solutions, but we also train them to learn to understand the business side of data science. And those programs will train you to become a certified data scientist. And the other program is oriented more for business professionals and managers, where the emphasis is on learning to integrate data and analytics into your work, exploring the value of data in your particular business. And we will train them to become a certified analytics translator. Now, I can imagine that you want to know more. If that's you, then this is how to go about it. You have already met Chantal, and if you want to know more about it, then Chantal is going to be a very important person in your life, because she can help you. She is happy to talk it over with you. You can also find a lot of information on our website. You can join us in an information evening, either online or hopefully soon in our very atmospheric campus. And Chantal can also organize that you can meet with me or an alumnus or one of our professors. That's my story, my friends.